here with Team Illuminati. We've covered this before. They were an X-Prize entry. I think I characterized them as the ugliest electric car on the planet.
Woo!
Now that I see it in person, I'm not far wrong, but actually, it starts to grow on you. Kevin Smith is the head of that. He's brought a good portion of his team down to Cape Girardeau, 214 miles, with the Vehicle 7. Kevin, welcome to EVTV. Tell us, introduce your compadres here.
Well, I'm Kevin, and this is Josh Spradlin. He is my right-hand man in the build. He is our artistic guy. He's the guy that goes, yeah, I know this is aerodynamics, but dude, come on. And what else? The clay model, found all the parts, and things that went on and on for years. I'm probably missing a couple.
Bird-dogging parts is a big deal. I spend 2 hours a morning on this.
And he found our AC controller and motor. I said, look, this is our budget. It's all the money we have. Mm-hmm. We need all these parts. Mm-hmm. And a week later, he goes, got it. And I was like, no. And he's like, yeah. And it's exactly what XPRIZE wanted as far as this, that. And I'm like, sweet, buy it, done. 6 month lead time. Uh-oh. But yeah, magic at finding parts. We could sit next to each other, computers type in the exact same thing. Water bottle. Mine would come up with Christmas tree ornaments. And I was like, how the heck do you spell that? And I'm like, I think I got it right. And like Josh told you earlier, I'll just keep talking, sorry. And we have Nathan Knappenberger. Nate came in, he saw our first article in a paper. Josh worked across the way from him. He goes, I want to do this.
Mm-hmm. I've actually been corresponding with Nate for a year and a half on electric vehicle things. He's their tech guy.
Yep. Electronics tech, electronics wizard, our electrical engineer, that actually a true electrical engineer, in my opinion, because he didn't go through the BS to get the piece of paper where that is the only proof he's an electrical engineer. Mm-hmm. He went through the BS where he actually did it and can still do it, and I'd hand him broken parts and go, Nate, this used to be a 5-volt supply. Mm-hmm. Sorry, man. He goes, well, find me some. Okay, we'll find it on something.
Mm-hmm. And I decided, hey, for my first electric car experience, I'm going to do an AC powertrain.
Yeah. They have a grand vision and are a little brash. They started with a clean sheet of paper, design a car from the ground up. No lack of ambition there. You guys are brazen. Nothing you've done is really the way I'd do it. And I'm not sure I even approve of most of it, but you just captured my heart. You can plan on going to the backyard and planting tomatoes, or you can plan on colonizing other planets. Either way, I'm a sucker for the guy that wants the big dream, and you all are brazen. Who's the short guy?
Short guy? This
That's
is new
Kevin.
Guy.
Oh, the other short guy.
The other short. He's only short because he's young. Mm. This is Matt. Matt is our intern. He showed up at a, what was that called, the meeting thing? Explorers
group. Show up.
Yeah, right, they just come out of the woodwork. Yeah.
Room full of high school students, pre-engineers and their folks, and they said, Kevin, could you come over and talk to us for a little bit? And I'm like, well, a little bit? Sure, okay, you asked for it. And then the presentation didn't work, and I said, well, I'll just have to wing this one. You guys got a couple hours? And they're like, oh, but we made it entertaining, and I put a bunch of them together in groups and made them do different, like, thought projects.
Our last intern was Matt. He cut a 240-volt AC cable with a pair of bolt cutters. We lose more interns that way.
Where is Matt?
He's not with us anymore.
After I heard that, I handed the tree snip to Matt, and I said, Matt, could you come here? He's like, yeah, sure, okay, what do you need? I said, I'm going to hold this, and you're going to cut it. And he goes, I'm not going to do either of those. I said, all right.
He'd seen video.
He's a keeper.
Good.
So he comes up to me after the meeting, and he goes, hi, I'm Matt. Can I come work with you guys? I said, we're working Saturday. Here's the address. Come on out. And we're in the middle of a court. Didn't say anything else.
I told him to mark it. And he comes at me with a set of bolt cutters. And for some reason, I just had a mental lapse. It made sense. Well, yeah, I guess we could just go ahead and cut it.
You did cut it too, didn't you?
Oh, yeah.
All the way through?
All the way through. It's
the cutters?
And it's right length.
Cutters still work?
No, we lost the cutters.
Cutters. Yeah.
And the intern. but the cable's perfect.
Well, that's what's important, because getting another length of cable.
Kevin, where are you all based out of?
Where are we all what out of? Based,
where
oh, based out of. Sorry, I also have a slight hearing problem. That's why I talk too loud. Mm-hmm. Well, one of my excuses. Based out of Divern in Illinois. It's a little bit south of Springfield.
Huh. Cornfield. So, Abe Lincoln country.
Yes, Abe Lincoln
in the
country.
Corn.
Yeah.
So, in a cornfield in Divern in Illinois, you all came up with a concept. You're going to build an electric car from dirt, Martha Stewart style.
It was actually, yes.
And win the X-Prize.
And win the X-Prize.
Yeah.
We got second place.
Or placed second, you know.
They had a clutch blowout on them. I've got a Geo Metro transmission in this thing. But they had to do it in public. We do ours here in the quietness of the garage.
And, we
and we've done
it.
Several clutches, Kevin. It's not a sin. But we have a very different view of failure than you guys do. Everybody in here is a failure. We've all failed at 7 or 8 things in our lives and have huge scars from it. We actually think that's where the value of things comes from. If you'd have won the X Prize, what could you have left out? What part didn't you have to do?
Since we didn't win, we probably didn't have to do any of it.
Well,
however,
well, no, you know exactly what went wrong.
Yeah.
And we took the transmission off.
And this has been a learning process for us, too, if you've watched the videos. We've twisted tool steel 4 inches long, 40-41.
We have too, but we used a Nate.
We've been through several clutches, and what we're learning is, and you don't always have control of this, as you're playing with these inverters and controllers. Sometimes they do what they want to do.
Sometimes the vehicles do what they want
to do. And sometimes the vehicles do what they want to do. But an internal combustion engine, which all these drivetrain parts are designed for, spool up when mm-hmm. you press the accelerator.
You spool down, kind of.
An electric motor, you can apply full force in 5 milliseconds.
Give or take a quarter millisecond.
Yeah, right. Well, it's not a half a second. It's a different time zone. And steel doesn't like that.
No.
And clutches don't like it at all.
No, they don't.
And so there are some special considerations in drivetrains. And if we're not living on the edge, these guys are. They have driven here today from Divernon. How many miles?
It's 214.
Let me make a telephone call here. Actually, I only talk on the phone about 3 times a week to my wife. I use it as a calculator. And I'm kind of slow. Nate, we're talking 99 cells. Mm-hmm. They're 100 amp hour?
Yes.
I count those as 3.35 volts times 100 would be 33,165 watts, watt hours.
Roughly.
And you think it was 214 miles?
Yeah, give or take a quarter mile up or down the hill around here.
What's that car weigh?
2,900.
You all are pretty much in defiance of the laws of physics, as my viewers keep relating them to me.
My physics professor, 155
watt hours per mile. They got here on one charge. They didn't have much left when they rolled in, but they were still at, what were you, 286 volts?
Yeah, static voltage was 286. Under load, it was about 178, 177. It was a very light load.
286 divided by 99. You're at 2.88 volts per cell. Hopefully all of them kind of balanced at the bottom, I hope.
Actually, yes.
That was Matt's second job. He did really well.
That's a lot of fun, isn't it, Matt? You learn a lot about these cells, don't you?
We took pictures of them at the table going like this with all the batteries. I said, I'm going to show this to your mom because it looks really bad, even though they're not all hooked up. So we took it from an angle where it looked like he was just playing with fire, you know, and posted that picture. And his mom goes, mm-hmm. thanks for posting the picture.
So that's pretty much on the vertical wall, that discharge curve, but 214 miles, that's 155 watt-hours per mile. We don't have a car in the joint that does that.
You do today.
Speedster Duh, which is our lightweight, I guess, 2,039 pounds, and with AC, a high-performance EVS system, I can coax that into about 220 watt-hours per mile. You're 75 watt-hours more efficient with a 2,900-pound car. Now, they think in miles per gallon, which we don't even have gallons around here.
How'd we do that?
But that's pretty efficient. In fact, it's startling. This is something to take note of. These guys built a car from scratch that does 155 watt-hours per mile. That's on the freeway. What were you driving? What speed?
We were going about 55 to 60 most of the way.
Mm-hmm. You have a lot of hills here.
A little faster to start with.
This is hilly country. This is a 2,900-pound car. That's phenomenal. There's guys on motorcycles can't do that. This is remarkably efficient. They do use the same motor, basically, I guess a little bit bigger one than we use on the Mini Cooper and the Tim 600.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And Thunder Sky, 100 amp hour cells.
Yep.
Speak up, Nate. This is your part, the electrical stuff. Well, man, jump in.
Yeah, they're Thunder Skies.
Mm-hmm.
There was they were marketed to us as, we have most of them are they say they were made by Calp for Thunder Sky, so they're made to Thunder Sky spec. So we consider they're Thunder Skies.
Mm-hmm.
They act like 100 amp hour batteries.
What color are they?
Blue and yellow.
Blue and yellow.
Well, we've got some yellow and some blue.
Some yellow and some blue.
So we've actually mixed two different batteries, but they were both 100 amp hour cells, and they're both acting like 100 amp hour cells.
Hmm.
We bottom balanced them all together.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And yeah, charging them then works just fine.
Well, I've got to believe it's the aerodynamics, and your car is narrower than what I had envisioned. Let's do a little walk around and see what we've got here. Let's take a look at the front of the car. All right, we're here at the front, and one of the things I liked was your name of the car, Seven. What's that? The first six didn't make the cut?
First six didn't make the cut. Seventh time's a charm. Lucky number seven. Whatever you want it to be. Seven is a number that the Masons use. It has some mystical symbology. And since we're the Illuminati and we magically get our, 155 watt-hours per mile, I mean, you know.
Uh-huh. So seven, magic name.
And no one else was using it at the time.
Is that right?
Yep.
Nope. I like it. They just call it seven, not the seven or anything. It's just seven.
That'd be like calling it the Facebook.
Seven. Yeah, the Facebook. Right, exactly. What do we got going here?
Well, we have our Tim's, this inverter.
Mm-hmm.
It's the basically kind of like your stereo amp at home, but this drives an electric motor.
Mm-hmm.
And this is our electric motor. It's a 40 kilowatt MES DEA motor. We routinely push over 130 kilowatts through it.
Mm-hmm.
We have our DC to DC converter, which mm-hmm. is also MES DEA. It's 1,000 watt. We don't need 1,000 watt. Here is our Geo Metro transmission over here. Mm-hmm. And we converted that from a 5-speed to a 2-speed. And since it's an electric motor, you can start off at zero in either gear. We mm-hmm. put it in third if we want to have fun, and fourth if we want to go for efficiency.
It's 1% more efficient in fourth.
Is that right?
And this is I think it's a Suzuki GSXR radiator.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a brushless DC pump. It's the
Bosch.
The Bosch pump.
Okay, so like our Mini Cooper, you're liquid cooled on the controller and on the motor. And these two heat exchangers are doing enough to keep them cool?
They kept us cool all the way here.
They came 214 miles. I put my hand on it. Again, it's just kind of like ours. Motor a little warmish, the controller not. It was body temperature. And there's your charge port.
Yep. We used a connector I was familiar with. It's a Neutrik connector. It's rated for 240 volts, 32 amps. Mm-hmm. And we can't charge at a higher amperage than that. Our voltage is a little bit higher, but when you do rectify AC to DC, mm-hmm. it's seeing more voltage than we're getting into our pack. So its insulation rating is good.
It's also it's a locking connector. They have communications and power connectors, so we've got the communication and power that talks to the charger, and it's ground first.
Yeah, make break.
Make break first make. Last. So it met the requirements of the XPRIZE, and it was one of very few connectors we could find that did that.
And it's affordable. And it's
it was like $13, and we got a whole bag of them.
So you carry your Manzanita charger, and it's sort of external to the car,
not built in.
But you have two connectors to plug it in. What's that about?
We have a switch that allows us to enable the charge.
We can
connect our charger, and then we flip a switch on the dash, and that allows it to enable the Manzanita to apply current to our pack to charge our cells.
Okay.
It can also... We route it through a meter that if it gets too high, it can disable the charge current.
So that enables the big pop when you hook up the cap of the Manzanita to the battery.
Yeah, it's just, and it also closes our contactors and does stuff whenever it's switched on.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that our DC to DC converter runs and keeps our 12-volt system charged. To hold our contactors close.
We've got some headlights from a 39 Lincoln, is that right?
Yeah, 39 Ford Coupe. They used them 37, 38, and 39.
The guy hasn't even noticed they're gone. I mean...
they invited us to SEMA in 08, the 42 finalists, and Josh and I were there, and we're like, oh, hey, look at this. This will fit perfect.
It's a couple actually, screws. It was done deal.
Actually, we went home, and Josh found them online. Mm. It's a reproduction. You want to call it the can, the glass, the light, all that stuff was really
the light
good.
Bezel.
The only thing that doesn't fit really well, the only part that they made in China that didn't quite fit right was the bezel. But when you looked at it on the 39 Ford that was at the show in SEMA, it didn't fit this well, and it was made for that car.
Tell me about the headlights.
The headlights, from Truck Light, they're an LED headlight, and I think they're running about 15 watts for a unit on high. And you consider we're doing 155 watt hours per mile, 15 watts, it makes a difference because when you run two of them, 30 watts.
What's a set of normal high intensity discharge headlights?
High intensity discharges, I think you bought some, for power utilization?
Yeah.
I think it's 50 watts.
It's 6 or 8 amps around the headlights.
Yeah,
that's 6
this
amps.
This is a fraction of an amp.
Yeah, 70 watts per headlight or for both?
Yeah, probably 8 amps at 12 volts.
90, that's almost 100 watts.
100 watts for a pair of those. Can you flip these on?
Sure.
These put out enough light to be a headlight?
Yes, they do. We drive at night
low.
In the country.
Mm-hmm. There's high.
I've been looking for these. I haven't. There keeps being rumors of them. Well, where do you get them?
Hang on. Awesome opportunity here. There's only one place you can get them, and they're not a sponsor yet, but they could be. Napa.
Napa. And what's one of those run?
They're now down to $309 a piece.
Whoa, that's kind of pricey. But they use 15 watts on high.
Yeah.
And they make enough light to be a headlight.
Plenty.
You can see the road at night.
Yeah, they don't make heat. They just make light. That's one of the good things about LEDs.
They're the only DOT-approved street-legal LED headlight as of right now. Uh-huh. When we got these about 2 years ago, I had to sign a military waiver to get them. I got them directly from Truck Light. Said, you will not give these to enemy combatants, blah, 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 blah. Within a month, they called me and goes, if you need more, go to Napa.
Ah, okay.
I'm like, what changed quick?
Yeah, I was unaware. I had checked this. It's been a year or so, but and they just weren't ready. But this is we're going to dig out the part number and put that.
We can fill the bucket. It isn't even getting warm with these.
Mm-hmm. They're quite cool. The lens is cool. The bucket's it's cold.
Now, bucket will get warm in one spot after enough time.
The turn signal light. We didn't put LEDs for our turn signal lights yet. We have some to put
in. We've got some replacements at home, but that's a real special bulb. We couldn't even find orange replacements. We found clear amber replacements.
Uh-huh. It's like a period bulb for 1939.
It's a 1007 series bulb. And yeah, the parts guys went, it's a what? And if you search online, you won't find.
This is fascinating. We're going to go to this. They're still a little pricey, but they'll come down over time.
Oh yeah, I'm sure the price has come down now since they've been out in the market a couple years.
A lot of guys have been putting them on motorcycles that have been having troubles with their electrical system, and their light's going dim. Oh, they put this, it doesn't require as much power. It's bright again. They think that's the solution. Mm-hmm. Well, it's a temporary solution, but
yeah.
Well, efficiency is the cumulative sum of what you do, not any particular thing, and this would be a huge gain. We have LED lights all through the car except the headlights, and we've got the high intensity discharge. I like the light.
Mm-hmm. It's almost the same color, I think.
But it's they take quite a bit of power to run. So
those are just 7-inch.
They're just 7-inch.
So this is, if you were to take these out, which is a real pain in the butt, these are actually military-grade lights. The back have all these aluminum cooling fins. They're the drab green because they were designed and made for the military.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so.
Okay.
Have to work in like 160 to minus 50 degrees Fahrenheit.
So. Well, that's fascinating. You've got a very clean, power section here. I'm quite taken with it. Let's take a look over on the side. This is the side of the vehicle. I'll give you a little different view. Now, what's the body made of? It's kind of thick here.
Well, you can see some of the straight lines here. This is 1-inch tube steel, 95 thousandths wall thickness. We built the entire space frame from that. You can see some of the tubes run through the doors. Everything had to work before we actually applied the body. We didn't know how to make a body and then make it fit on the car. And so what we did is, after we got the space frame on and got all the doors and the hoods and the trunk suspension and steering working, we then filled all the interseating spaces with a high density, foam. Right, it's 6 pounds per cubic foot foam, closed cell. And ordered that in like a bunch of big 4x8 sheets, cut it up, filled all the spaces, and put a couple layers of 10 ounce fiberglass.
Your dad cut most of those, I think.
Yeah, Dad cut almost all of them.
Nick Smith.
There's a few of our members that didn't make it. Mm-hmm. Today, not that they haven't made it.
Oh, how many did you lose building this car?
The X-Prize is pretty rough, you know.
There were thousands.
Well, it's a contact sport.
Yeah. Well, we kind of made it. Never mind. What we did from that is we built off of it using a spray foam, high density closed cell spray foam. Josh and I sprayed the whole car the basic shape we wanted after we bent the steel in the wood burning stove to get the curves for the front. And then we bent like brake line to follow along out, and then tack welded it over here. And I'm, how are we going to open the door later? I'm like, oh, we'll cut it open or something. And we went around and sprayed and sprayed and sprayed the basic shape, and we started cutting it down by hand. How long did that take, Josh?
Mm-hmm. 3 days. 3 days?
About three. Hand saws, what looks like cheese grinders, those little scraper things that don't work on anything, they work awesome on foam. And files and sandpaper, and just kind of carve the shape out of it. And then to get the doors and windows and stuff open, Josh shoved me through where the windshield's supposed to go. I poked holes where the metal was, we marked it on the outside, then took a pneumatic cutter, drew some lines, and just carefully cut them out, cut the windows, cut the doors, kicked them open, and...
I don't think that's how Special Editions does ours, is it, Brian?
Why not?
That's close.
Is it something like that?
Yeah.
Okay. So you've got kind of an interesting cockpit here. You all made all this, the dash and you've got a steering column.
The steering column is from Flaming River, Josh? Okay, Flaming River steering column, a Grant steering wheel, an adapter, it's tilt steering, and then just the connectors from Flaming River to hold the column on. But yeah, we made the dash, all the supports, the backbone three times. It's amazing how many times you can cut a backbone out and not twist the car.
Mm-hmm. Tell me about the gull wing doors.
They're cool, right?
Yeah, I don't know. It depends. I was having a conversation with Kevin by telephone about how do you order a hamburger. That was the Aptera killer on one of their rounds of funding. It was a guy asked, well, how do you order a hamburger at McDonald's? And he was telling me that these doors don't actually exist in real time. How does that work?
Really? Step right here.
All right.
Right there.
All right. I'm right here.
Yeah, somewhere around there should do. Okay. All what right. happens if I open and close a regular car door and you're standing there?
I would be knocked down.
Very possibly. What happens with this one?
Wow. That's pretty close.
16 inches.
I practiced with the other members that aren't with us for a long time to know where you had to stand.
Uh-huh.
Matt made it.
There you go. Well, that's so you've got some are those gas struts or that
yes.
hold it open?
Yeah.
Gas struts. What is the name of the company? It's in a place in Canada that custom makes them. Huh. And they sent us a few till we found some that were strong enough. Those are 900 or 1,000 newtons each.
Mm-hmm. And this is pretty simple. You've got a Victron here. What's this? Your speedometer?
What's the speedometer?
Dakota
means?
Digital.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Josh found it. He knows more about those.
So that's pretty simple instrumentation.
We also had a rear view camera in the middle. That's a little Velcro uh-huh. piece. We've still got the camera, but we don't have the screen in. It was
it's didn't almost like, more trouble than it's worth.
Yeah, and it didn't like the heat. It was a color screen, and it became black and white. And, mm-hmm. and then at night, it looked like you were in warp speed in Star Trek, and all you saw were these like stars moving away.
And you've got this center console with cup holders. Yeah. That's actually where your batteries are, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yep. And behind, in between the seats.
Uh-huh. And all the way
all the way
back.
Down, right, all the way down to the back, between the back seats as well.
Mm-hmm.
We've got three rows of 100 amp hours going back. There's, let's see, there's 21 in each side, so that's 42 from 96 is about, what, 54? Yeah, 54 down the backbone. Oh, wait, 99 now. So, sorry, we're up to 99. So add 3 to that. We got
And your rear seat passengers, they more get to see where you've been than
right,
where yeah. you're
going. Face backwards. Part of the aerodynamics was if we had them facing forwards, the car has to be narrow enough that we sit between the length of the tires and not the width of the car. So we had to make the car longer, face the rear passengers backwards to start getting the taper on the top of the car. You need about a 1-4 taper at 65 miles an hour to try to prevent that little air suction at the end. You know, aerodynamic uh-huh. rule of thumb.
Yeah, I noticed the taper.
We turned them
how
around.
How many daughters do you have, Jack?
Five.
Yeah.
Five
it's
daughters.
It's a pretty safe back seat for daughters to
yeah,
take
we
the
had,
car.
Yeah, we had a father-son that came out on one of the visitation days, and the son was about Matt's age. You know, he's 17. And Dad goes, I like the car, but the kid's got a good point. He goes, terrible date car. I'd never buy it. I said, this is your son? And he goes, yeah, it is my son. He's about 17. Yeah. I said, imagine
it's
this.
Perfect date
I said,
car.
Now,
it's
imagine,
a perfect date
I said,
car.
Now imagine this is your 17-year-old daughter. He goes, I'll take two.
Exactly.
But yeah, we face them backwards in order to shorten the length of the car. If we faced them forward, your head would be back here and you'd be outside the car.
The car would be like mm-hmm. 21 feet long.
And this gives 25. You headroom forward, but you can taper the car back.
Yeah.
And allowed us to put a triangle in here.
Mm-hmm.
Cause, you and know, that's really strong.
Mm-hmm. It's a, what are you venting here?
That was our battery vent for cooling the batteries, which
and if you ask
we
Chrysler,
found to be
still
not
is.
Necessary.
You don't need to cool.
No, they don't.
You might need to heat them.
They actually like to be a little warm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I keep asking the question to China, what would happen if I ran these batteries at 40 degrees centigrade? Because on the bench, I get a lot better mm-hmm. performance. The answer keeps coming back, 25 degrees centigrade. Okay.
That's, yeah. Well, we tried working with a couple Chinese companies, too, until we got the batteries that we have now in there. And they're like, well, we'll develop a pack for you. We'll make a pack. What do you need? I need something between 320 and 360 volts. Okay. 3 weeks later, we had three engineers work on it. We cannot do that. And
if,
I'm like,
if you find
why
it
not?
Difficult to communicate with them by email, Sharon from Chinook oh, yeah. called me this morning on the telephone from China. Kind of an emergency FedEx mm-hmm. customs problem with a charger I ordered. Email's the way to go. You don't really want to talk to them directly.
Yeah.
I couldn't make
well,
out
not
any
to
of
talk
it.
One?
I did agree, but I'm not sure to what.
You'll let's, find out when the bill comes.
One of the things I'm fascinated with by is how narrow this car is. This did not come across on any of your videos properly. Let's take a look at the back of this car.
Evnetics Electric Vehicle Systems presents the Soliton One Controller. 1,000 amps of continuous power at up to 340 volts. enough power to drive your dream car while automatically protecting your precious battery pack. Built-in contactors and pre-charged circuit reduces parts count. Each Soliton One controller undergoes rigorous dynamometer qualification. An easy-to-use web interface configuration with real-time data logger through an Ethernet connection. The only controller with programmable idle function ideal for automatic transmissions. Liquid cooling for high power operation. Evnetics Soliton One. Very dangerous, very high voltage.
We're at the rear of 7, and one thing that did not come across on all your videos was how narrow this car tapers to in the back. We're seeing 50 inches here on the edge, and that tapers from what in the front?
We're about 65 in the front.
At the widest point.
At the widest point, yeah.
And so we're tapering this way. That's very good aerodynamics, but also this way. Again, LEDs, what are these?
AutoZone LEDs that you can get off the shelf.
Uh-huh.
Because we could get them quickly and
they were available.
Yeah.
And there's easily. No red requirement or amber.
Oh no, this is red. This is red.
Oh, these are red.
They're red LEDs. Mm-hmm. And the white for the reverse.
Oh, okay.
These bottom lights here are actually fog lights. Huh. And we use them for backup lights.
Can you turn them on?
Yeah.
Sure.
Let's see them. I like
you
lights.
Get it, Josh?
So you can kind of see the gull wing doors all open there. Oh yeah.
We got a third brake
red,
light.
You got little amber ones here.
Yep. No, they're not on now. There you go.
There you are. And how about these? These are your reverse lights?
Yeah, turn the car on and put it in reverse.
Oh. Don't drive it away.
It won't go anywhere unless we'll.
All right.
You went past reverse.
There you go.
And the red ones, there's a turn signal, there's a turn signal. Cool.
And the only thing that didn't work when the Secretary of State came out to inspect the car to give us our plates and title,
mm-hmm.
was this license plate light.
Hmm.
And it's because while at the competition, one of the turn signal powers went out, and so somebody swapped it off of the because mm-hmm. we didn't need the license plate light there. So they go, everything else looks good. If you fix that, we'll put a VIN on it for you. And I said, I think I can fix that.
Well, we got a little lever here. Is this for?
It's for opening the trunk. Yeah.
Ah, and you actually have a little. Actually, you have a great big trunk.
Yeah. It fits Kevin in a shovel very well.
Yeah, you can put a couple kids in there.
You can fit one body, a bag of lye, and a shovel.
Uh-huh, that's all you need. So, yeah, fascinating. So this will kind of give you an idea of the profile of this car from behind. And that aerodynamics at 55 miles per hour has got to be part of the key to that 155 watt hours per mile on a 214 mile run. With basically a 33 kilowatt pack.
Yep.
We've got that much batteries, certainly in the Mini Cooper. It's a little heavier at 3,500 pounds, but we can barely get 100 miles out of the same pack size. So you all have done well on the efficiency, and I have to believe the contour of the car is part of that. I do have to ask about the fill cap.
That was part of the requirement for the XPRIZE. We needed a fill port for fire suppression in case the batteries were to have a thermal incident.
Mm-hmm.
And that ducts into our battery pack. That fire nozzle will fit in that.
It had to be 3.54 inches or larger. And Josh found it. It is a European aviation
cap on my King Air 200.
And they don't make that size or larger here. It was specifically uh-huh. Great Britain for a very specific plant. And of course, Josh is parts guy, and mm-hmm. he found it. He goes, I found it. You aren't going to like it. I'm like, why not? What's it look like? He goes, oh, that's not it.
It looks like $450.
it looks like this thing with an L next to it that I think is pounds, and it's more than me. And then shipping was another issue, and I was like, oh, well, we gotta have it, so.
Yeah, no, they have just an awful lot of people setting requirements as if they know something, and this thermal issue would be okay if they could just dump water in a tube.
Actually, the thermal issue with dumping water in the tube, they decided that that was more important than the Lithex fire extinguisher that we had to have. There were only 5 in North America. We found someone that could get one to us at an exorbitant price within the 3 days that we had before we had to be at the event.
What kind of fire extinguisher was it?
A Lithex. It's a Class D, I think it was Class D fire extinguisher. And it's specifically for metal fires, and it's for lithium fires. That's why it's a Lithex.
I didn't even know they had.
We had one of 2 at the event. XPRIZE was able to get one. We were able to get one. And the local fire department told them, well, you really can't put enough fire extinguishing material on the car if you have a battery fire. What they had luck with in their practices was trying to drown the batteries, because it didn't stop the fire, but it cooled it down long enough they could get the dummies out of the car. So that's all they were going for at that point. They're like, okay, we can't put it out, but we can put it, you know, we can cool it long enough, we can get the dummies, the driver, me, out of the car before there's other problems. But you know the batteries that we're using, basically the Thunder Skies, and I joked with the judges, some of them got it, some of them didn't. They asked what all your safety, this, that, and the other thing, and you know, where's your fire suit and this and that, and I said, well, you know, as a last safety precaution, I've got a light on the dash that Josh wired up for me. Nate wired up for me, the other Josh. It goes off when the car hits 2,500 degrees, and that's when I bail.
Well, there you go.
2 of the judges did that, and the other 2 went, wait, what is this?
Well, they're busy.
They were very busy. They were running around trying to figure out everyone's car, and they're like, okay, is this safe? Everyone had a different approach to it. We were the only ones that the negative end of the battery pack was at the back of the car, and we had to run a cable back to the
front.
They
had never seen that before.
And they're just like, what do we do? But, well, you have this and that, and you have the brake, but we need the kilovac and the fuse up front. And said, now you said within 3 foot of the battery pack. That's 3 foot.
That's the end of the battery pack's right there.
So. But yeah, then once they understood the design of the car, then they're like, oh yeah, that works great. And then with the filler cap on top, they said, we wish we had known of that cap. We would have required everyone to have it. It's easy to put a little sticker on, and it's large enough everyone can find. It would be uniform. Other people were using stickers that match their car paint, and you had to break it. And they're like, okay, well, how does the fire department find that? I said, well, once it gets hot enough, it burns it off, and then they can.
There you go. Yeah, that sounds like quite an adventure, just meeting the technical requirements for the XPRIZE. It was kind of a mess from the beginning. It was sponsored by Progressive Auto Insurance, and then had to all be done on a track because they couldn't insure any of the cars.
Actually, Progressive ended up insuring the cars.
Did they? We
were insured to drive on the road as long as we were titled. So we got titled before the insurance ran out, which was this last February, and we were out driving. We had our insurance card, no problem. Reinsuring it was a little more difficult. We could only find 1 company that would do it.
Who's that?
Progressive.
Progressive.
And they would only do it because they were keeping tabs on all of us. Apparently, we had to go through their agents, and it took a while for the agent to figure out what was going on and get to the right person. Like, no, we're keeping tabs on all the XPRIZE cars because we want to see where these cars go. We got a special insurance policy set up for them.
Okay.
So. We're still insured by Progressive, not to be a commercial form or anything, but for a one-off custom-built car, they did give us a pretty good deal. It's cheaper than the fire extinguisher.
Cheaper than the fire extinguisher. Okay. Well, Kevin, it's a very interesting car, and really quite, some of it. I was completely lost with the mile per gallon metrics that they used. We'll show a bit on the other side of the card. He's got a Windows sticker, an EPA sticker, but we count things a little differently. When you put it in terms of 155 watt hours per mile, I think it's phenomenal. And that you built this in a cornfield in Di Vernon, Illinois, from scratch, it's really quite an accomplishment. I have to tell you, it's still probably one of the ugliest cars I've ever seen. But the more I look at it, I mean, it does kind of start to grow on you after a while, you know? It's like, you know, I can't, it's like the schnauzer puppy or the bulldog puppy. He's so hideously ugly that after a while you kind of think he's cute. And this is sort of the same thing. You could still do a little bit on the finish.
We were trying to get to the race. And
it's starting to look good to me now that I'm looking at the and a lot of touches here that I'm taking a notebook to. These LED taillights and LED headlights and you know, a lot of the things you've done to this car, we're just going to steal outright. I had already copied your Moonai hubcaps on Speedster Part Duh. And I think we've got some headlight changes in our future, so we'll learn from whoever we can, wherever we can find it.
Yeah. We list most of the stuff on our website, too, if you can find it. It's rather extensive, but yeah, we tell you everything. We had lots of people coming up to us, well, what motor do you use? You know, and they wouldn't tell us what theirs was. I'm like, well, you know, it's the MES, DEA, this, that, the other thing.
And half the people in the country are declaring things secret that don't even matter.
Everything pretty much is off the shelf, which is kind of amazing that if you just put it together right, you could buy everything.
However, you would be impressed how many patents we have on this car.
How many patents do you have on?
Let's take a guess. I mean, ground up car.
If I had to pick a number, it would be 7.
That is real close. You're only over by 7. 0. Not worth it unless you're going into production, and then it's only to protect your own butt.
Yeah.
There were a lot of people getting patents on stuff that they were never going to use. A drivetrain that they didn't build. Let's see, you used their transmission and their motor. Mm-hmm. Oh, and you had a machinist make a coupler plate. That's not a patent.
Yeah, right.
I mean,
it's America's gone IP crazy.
Yeah.
Elon Musk has done a whole portfolio of patents on the Tesla, but he also has another company called SpaceX, and his biggest competitors, China and France. He says, I can't get enforcement on them anyway, so we've never patented anything.
Yeah.
And
save
they have a lot more innovation in SpaceX than they do on the Tesla. So it gets to be kind of
rough. Didn't they just have a successful launch of a heavy lift vehicle, SpaceX?
Yes, they are hitting on all cylinders on that company too.
Nice.
I don't think these automotive guys know who's taking them on. Elon Musk is not a car guy. He started PayPal. He's Silicon Valley, and he cashed out on PayPal big time, and he's going in all directions at once. He has a solar company that does solar installations on homes. SpaceX, which is a heavy lift company that has 40 contracts now, 17 of them with NASA, and a Tesla is his part-time job.
He wanted electric cars, so he decided he'd do that too.
I got a deposit down on the Model S, and about $1 million bet on the Tesla stock. And,
wow.
That Model S is beautiful. The engineering and it is just gorgeous.
All aluminum, the way they've got that laid out. You will never see a sedan that size with that much room in it anywhere, simply because of what he's not doing. There's no engine in the engine compartment. There's no trunk in the trunk. It's this thing is truly an innovative design, except the shape, and right down to the door handles are pretty much an Aston Martin Rapide.
I've seen that.
And we pulled up a white Aston Martin Rapide photograph right next to the Tesla S, and Matt Hauber said, look at this. And I looked, and I'm like, which is which? And it was like Tesla's on the left.
You can tell by the emblem on the hood.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the real power in our economy and in America is about innovation and continuous innovation. And it's not driven by the people with PowerPoint presentations flailing around trying to sell intellectual property. And we had another one this week, Boston Power. Great website. If you want to see a cool website, go to Boston Powers. They've got a great battery, 150 watt hours per kilogram, almost unbelievable amount of power. And it's probably the clearest data sheet I've ever seen on a battery. None of it exists. This is pure fantasy.
What do we call it?
It does not exist in real time. Yeah. These people are complete fraud, and they've got thousands of people going to their website and trying to call them and stuff and wasting millions of man hours dealing with a company that doesn't exist and a product that doesn't exist. And I can't tell you how many of these that I've come across.
The overhead on a product that doesn't exist, though, is almost zero, so your profit margin's huge.
You know it is. I try to be sympathetic, but they're so annoying with it that I can't be. If I had a battery the size of a pack of cigarettes sitting here that would run your car for 1,000 miles on a charge, but it isn't free. Let's say it costs us $7,500 to produce this thing. So we're going to have to sell it for $10,000 or $12,000.
Mm-hmm.
What would we do with it?
I'd get two of them.
Yeah. And that's about what we'd wind up with, is with two of them. Because to do the production line to produce these in any quantity and any economy of scale, all we have to do is come up with $40 million. And who are we going to sell the battery to? All our viewers think there's a million of them. There's probably 6,000 now truly electric cars,
right,
in the world.
But if you had a battery that size...
We only talk about electric cars. We only talk to electric car guys. After a while, you think that's the whole world. Statistically, you do not exist. You're not detectable with test instruments. You're not on planet. You don't exist.
Hey, we're a high percentage of the people in our area. Because there's, no one else in the shop.
No one else in the shop except you guys.
For miles until you get to the highway.
There's almost 100% electric car ownership there.
Yeah, within a square mile.
Within a square mile, it's 100% electric car. You get in this mindset, and I have to remind people, if you count all the volts, all the leaps, all the prototypes, all the experiments, the 1,650 Teslas, everything on EV album, and kind of multiply that by three, and you're going to question me on this, check EV album, two-thirds of its motorcycles. I'm talking about cars. Mm-hmm. Lithium-powered cars, now we're down to 200.
Four-door sedans.
Right. Yeah. Right. Never mind four-door sedan, just a car that's not a lawnmower, not noticeably a motorcycle, running on a lithium cell. We're in the hundreds. And if you figure the population's three times what's on EV album, you're still, you haven't reached 1,000 yet. There's not 6,000 cars in the world. So with our cigarette pack battery, what would we do with it? And that's the problem. It would be very interesting. What's the market for it? We're going to sell them at $12,000 a battery to who?
Wouldn't be anyone to start with, because it's too expensive. You'd have to put it into a few different vehicles and show what it could do.
Wait a minute. You've got
but our
$10,000 in the batteries in here.
Exactly. That's why I said I'd buy two of them. I'd put them in here and get rid of the 800 pounds, and we'd be set to go.
Exactly.
We'd have three connectors.
The paradigm.
As far as a market and scaling it up beyond the prototype or doing half a dozen one-offs, mm-hmm, to show people how do you produce this battery.
I know what I'd do.
It takes $40 million to set this up. It's a small-scale battery production, and you're going to sell them to who? So to raise money or to do any of this, it doesn't make any sense. The battery market is a commodity market. During some periods, some swings, you can buy lead acid batteries at Walmart and turn them in at the metal trading depot and pick up a couple of bucks.
Yep.
They're selling them for 6% over the cost of the metal, and if it swings just right, you can buy new batteries and turn them in for junk and make money on it.
If you had that battery, I kind of what I'd do. I'd convert your helicopter to be electric, because then power to weight ratio is no longer a problem.
That would be cool.
And the military would buy that. Imagine a perfectly silent helicopter, mm-hmm, going in. You hear a breeze. What's that? Too late.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things.
Oh, there's a lot of things that could be done with it.
And we'll have those available.
How do you produce it and sell it? And it takes some investment to build the production line, and you don't have any proven market for it at all. And so it's difficult to, and so that's basically what they do is a couple prototypes and a PowerPoint presentation, and try to find somebody that can help them either fund the development of the production line or buy their intellectual property. They have no interest in actually making the batteries and selling them to you at all. They have to have what they think OEM is a magic term for somebody that will come in and spend the $40 million to build the production line. And
they'll build their own production line.
It's actually better to keep making them one off and get some out and get them proven in the field and cause some flag waving. But they don't know this. They're not. They haven't done this before, and they think all money comes from General Motors or something, and that GM is some sort of charitable organization.
GM does stand for Generous Motors. Right?
Yeah, well, you're in the part of the country. Well, you're in the part of the country up there where all these guys sell the OEMs, and it's not as nice as you think.
No,
they're making bumpers for $35, making $1.25. Everybody in the plant's working for $8.50, and that's all up down the Mississippi River. And Generous Motors is not very generous.
They pay you $8.50 here? We've got to move.
Yeah. Well, then you'd have to pay more for your shop.
Yeah, we would.
All right, let's talk a little bit about your contest entry.
This episode of EVTV is brought to you by the Winston Battery Company Limited. Makers of high-capacity lithium-yttrium rare earth cells, including the popular 160 amp hour model featuring cycle lives in excess of 5,000 cycles when discharged to 70%, the longest useful working life of any available battery of any chemistry. A leading battery technology scientist, inventor, and entrepreneur since 1995, Mr. Winston Chung envisions a new world of clean electric power for the dawn of a new era of electric vehicles. For your next electric vehicle design project, contact Winston Battery Limited. Energy for a bright future.
Kevin, I gotta tell you, when I first discovered Illuminati's videos online, I thought you guys were the biggest clowns in EV land.
Thank you.
Doing everything upside down and backwards. But I was captivated by the grandness of your vision. It takes a certain amount of hubris to sit in a garage and make videos about electric cars and put them out and think anybody would care. And it takes a certain amount of hubris to sit in a cornfield and say, you know, we'll just enter the X prize, win $10 million, and beat out all the people that are doing that. And I am kind of a sucker for a grand vision. So I started watching it and was intrigued, but now that I've seen the car, I actually see some innovations and some developments here that I'm impressed by. We're going to steal your headlights, your taillights, probably not your flood fill system to drown the batteries. I don't think I need that. But,
no.
And you didn't either. But,
no, but you know.
How many cars did they have to use that on at the X-Prime?
None.
There you go. And there were plenty of breakdowns.
Oh, yeah.
The only way I've gotten any of these batteries to do a thermal incident is to overcharge them dramatically. And I can do that, and we can show that, but that's the only way you can get a thermal incident. We can blow a terminal off,
we tried
a connection, that sort of thing under the right conditions, but it doesn't start a fire. It usually welds the terminal and the bolt to something, and then that's the incident. So these... safety people were making up stuff, trying to come up with some criteria to theoretically be safe, and cluelessly. And I'm Again, you know, I'd like to congratulate you for competing in the extra prize. I know you're never going to accept this, but maybe later when you're older, looking back on it, you'll start to see why I say this. You have a treasure there, not in winning the X Prize, but in failing to win it, that is kind of remarkable. And when I think about your teamwork and the group you've kind of cobbled together there, I start to tear up. It's really, you're living largely, and you're doing it with a grand vision, and I would encourage you to continue that in all aspects of your life and demonstrate that to anybody that will look or listen. In the end, we kind of wind up in a white room full of white people in white clothes trying to figure out what final procedure they can build the government for before we pass.
Oh, that white clothes. No, okay.
And in the interim, it's good to dream big and think big and have a grand vision. I'm very impressed with it. Actually seeing the car, I've got a better view of the car and what you've done, and it's not bad. In fact, I think it's, again, ambitious. I would not encourage our viewers to start from a sheet of paper and build a car from dirt. It's a highly evolved creature, Darwinian in its nature, and it's taken 100 years to determine where to put the cigarette lighter. And all those little decisions are cumulative, and it's easier to start with a good car and then make it electric. But apparently you weren't after easy. And but I am impressed with what you put together there. We have named you the Master Flux nominee in the EV Build Your Dream contest. You're one of 10. They're all pretty good. And what? Tell me why our viewers might want to pick you as the recipient for a big pile of batteries and motor and controller and of course, a Master Flux, which they already use Master Flux, yeah. So that's they're familiar with it. You know, what? Why do our viewers want Kevin Smith and his team to take us into the future?
Well, we tried to show you what we could do with the X Prize entry.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, a lot of people thought we were nuts, couldn't do it. And,
I still think you're nuts.
And well, thank you. Actually,
that's not actually a bad thing in EVTV. That's not even, I don't understand, that is not a disparagement.
I'm sure it's the only reason I get through most days at work.
What do you do?
I work for the Illinois EPA. I write permits for the Bureau of Air.
Really?
Permit section, yeah. Companies come in, they're building something new, ADM or a U.S. Steel, something like that comes in, and they're, mm-hmm. they're putting in a new ethanol processing plant, or a new electric arc furnace or something like that. And there's a whole bunch of rules and stuff that cover those, and it gets really boring and technical, and I do what I call the big nasty mm-hmm. permits. There's a couple of rules that cover the people who are already way too big as far as emissions go,
mm-hmm.
and I think I work for the only agency, or I guess if you look at it as a company, but it's not, that where you tell people, well, you aren't that big, and they go, oh, thank you, because it's not the
so
size.
So seven's not really your first car.
No.
You went to school for what?
I went to school for chemical engineering
where?
At the U of I Chicago campus.
Uh-huh.
Most of the 6 years of it, you know, two uh-huh. years junior, 2 years senior. I was playing with other things with some of the guys. We were working on cars.
So, you were going to be a chemical engineer, but you got involved with the cars then, didn't you?
Yeah. I've still got a chemical engineering degree, a piece of paper in a folder hidden somewhere. Mm-hmm. I have no idea what it's good for.
And you'd use that at the drop of a hat if there was something to apply it to.
That I was interested in.
Right. Sure.
I thought I was really...
But what? How did you get involved with the cars going for a chemical degree?
UIC was working on a solar car at the time when I started at the school. and I wanted on that solar power team. Mm-hmm. At the time, I didn't know what the power requirements were, how much you got back from the solar cells, or how many square foot of area you needed, and how much energy there was from the sun hitting it, and that, you know, it really has to be like a 300-pound monocockpit, 95-pound little person inside at 130 degrees dying in order to make the car work.
Almost. And a 100 times larger sun.
Yes. or if we're just a little bit closer, say we're where Mercury is now.
Right.
Of course, the solar cells wouldn't like the heat, but and I wanted on that solar car team. Uh-huh. The thing is, it was kind of like building an EV. You could be building an EV and your neighbors not know that you're doing it. Mm-hmm. This is the same thing. I'm going to the college, go to the dean of engineering, and they're like, yeah, there's something like that going on around here. And I'm like, okay. Well, I finally met the guys two-thirds of the way through my first year. There was a competition to build bridges out of Tinker Toys. In high school, I did it out of toothpicks, and I won for the regional area. And, mm-hmm. and I was like, oh, cool, yeah, I want to do this. Because the prize was food. It was a pizza.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, yeah, let's do this.
Free food.
So I got there late. You're supposed to have a team of people working together. And I show up, and there's me, and there's this other guy standing there, and we're looking at these miscellaneous parts that are left over after everything's been picked through. And I said, well, I want to build a bridge. And they go, well, you have to have a team. And I go, he's my team. And he goes, yeah. I go, hi, I'm Kevin. So he goes, well, what do you want to do? I said, well, let's grab this and this and this and this and this and this and put it together and see what happens. Well, we didn't win, but we took second.
Hmm.
However, our bridge held, it was a cost to weight ratio. You put a bunch of weight on it, they gave an artificial price to the pieces, and whichever cost to weight ratio was the greatest, mm-hmm. we came in second. Our bridge did hold 28 or 9 times what the winning bridge held, though.
Mm-hmm.
I was harassing the people that had the winning bridge at the time. They were putting half-pound weights on it, one at a time, and then they'd take it off and put the 1 pound on. Uh-huh. And they'd add a half, and then take that off and put the 2 pound on. And they're sitting there, and they're calculating the whole time. I said, come on, put a 20 on it! Put a 20! And this went on for, like, 5 minutes till their bridge had like 5 pounds on it and broke.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, wow, that cost to weight ratio is really high. Cool, yay. So I put mine up there, and it's this monstrosity of leftover parts. It looks like the mousetrap game, held together with string that's twist tightened around the sides. Like, that'll never hold anything. And the judge is like, should we even test this? Like, I'll put the weight on it, move out of the way. And that guy, the head of the other team that I was harassing, goes, put a 20 on there. I said, okay. So I just went, dunk, dropped it on. And he's like, put another on. Okay. Dunk. And I did that 6 times. Mm-hmm. And I went, yeah, it's not going to hold much more. And he's like, okay, I'll be quiet now. And so I put a 5 on it, and it broke. And I'm like, I'm happy with that. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Ends up this other team was the solar car team.
Uh-huh.
So after meeting that way, they're like, yeah, nice to meet you. Who are you? And we're working on this project over here. And I'm like, well, what is it? And the solar car, I've been looking for you guys for 8 months.
Mm-hmm.
Got on the solar car team. Learned a lot about solar cars, you know, that they're not very practical,
mm-hmm.
Especially in 1991, when you're using lead acid batteries and mm-hmm. the low grade cells. But it evolved from there. The next thing we did was a hybrid mini Baja car. Society of Automotive Engineers, which is a college, Society of Automotive Engineers, you see SAE on your oil, mm-hmm. you know, the SAE oil and things like that. Well, they also have college groups, and they do different competitions. Mini Baja cars, which is like a go-kart with a full roll cage and a Briggs & Stratton engine in it. And mm-hmm. you take it out to a motocross track and try not to die, or at least hurt yourself severely. So we built a hybrid one, because we're like, wait a minute, the rules don't say that you can't be storing this energy.
Guys, how do you shut this guy down?
You don't. Everyone else already left. They warned you. I'm starting to wake up. I got 3 hours.
We
just kept going through all these competitions, and my roommate and I were sitting down one night, and he wanted to do this hybrid electric vehicle competition, 95 hybrid electric vehicle challenge, and he goes, I'm going to write a proposal. And I learned from him that if you say you're going to do it, other people will follow. And I'm like, how are we going to do it? He goes, I don't know, but we can figure it out. It's a motor, and it's an engine, and it's some batteries, and oh, okay, well, you're right. Let's write this up.
Mm-hmm.
And we won one of the cars, and we're like, all right, now I have to do it.
Mm.
So we got the car, and we had told the dean at the time what we were doing. He's like, that's great. I'll fund it if you guys get it. We got the car. We show up with the car. And, well, that was another story in itself. But and he goes, that's great, guys. Here's a check for $500. Have fun. And we're like, we spent more than that putting it in these nice little binders and shipping it off last minute at night and finding the back room in the post office in downtown Chicago where there's this lady there who goes, yeah, fine, give it to me, I'll stamp it today. And we're like, whoa, 11:58, we made it.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're like, now what do we do? Well, we started trying to raise money. We're no good at it. New dean came in and he goes, this is a good competition, boys. What kind of money do you need? We go, I don't know, $50,000. And he goes, I'll start you with 30. I'm like, all right. It cost us like 100 to do the car, but we did it, entered. We had a problem with, believe it or not, our coupler to the transmission. Mm-hmm. And that took us out of the competition, but we had a lot of fun.
You're going to pick up on this at some point, aren't you?
Which point?
About this motor transmission interface. It's some car, you're going to get this right.
That I thought I had it in this one. We did not make our own. I'm just like, okay, no. Clutch, flywheel, done, guys. We're bolting it up, and that's it. Mm-hmm. And it's, and I'm like, man, you know. And Josh is like, yeah, you said something about that coupler. And I'm like, yeah, this is like the third one. And then we had it. After the 95 Hybrid Electric Vehicle Challenge came the Partnership for Next Generation Vehicles in 96. Yeah. And that was our last big competition. And batteries at the time sucked. Mm-hmm. So we sat down and we wrote a proposal. We just cleared up the one from the year before. And we said, okay, we're going to do this. And then we went, the batteries suck. What are we going to do? Let's just do a stored air supercharger. Yeah, okay, we can do that. We took parts from the Neon, the AC units, pumped some air into some tanks, and instead of having a supercharger on there, which takes like 100 horsepower to produce an additional 100 horsepower for you to use, because we use this little Daihatsu engine, which was 40 horsepower, we use the air, we use 16 and 32 pounds of boost from stored air that we're using, and we used 5 horsepower to make it. You know, the top 5 we weren't using from the engine, and it worked great, but you know, most of the engines don't like 32 pounds of boost. And although the coupler was the first thing to go,
they like it real well until they blow.
Exactly. The coupler went by like a minute before the engine started pumping black smoke everywhere. And we're like, hey, oh, the coupler won. Well, the engine just went anyway, don't matter. And that was the last competition I did until this one. It had been 10 years between that one and when we started this one, but you know, I talked to the guys and they're like, we can't do this. And we worked it out just like we did the other competitions. They're like, well, dang, Kevin. Actually, this is the internet. I can say, damn, this is a different, damn, Kevin. This might work. Huh. And I said, and actually, we should be getting something like 200 or 300 miles to the gallon if we do this right. And they're like, that's a pretty good margin for error. Why, let's give it a try. See what happens.
The proposal you submitted was for an AMC Gremlin. Now, I want you to understand, and all the finalists understand, we selected it based on that, but you're going to have to make quite a bit of investment, even though we're sending you a big pile of stuff. You can do any car you want. Any of them can change it completely, but, you know, I'd urge you to sort of put that up on your write-up and photos and videos, you know, so our viewers can vote accurately, but we don't care what you do. What you submitted was caught our eye and everything, but it's your car, and you're going to do what you want to do, and I don't have a problem with that at all. So you can change it and do an airplane or a boat if you want. Now, we do have one guy doing a boat, you know, it's a finalist.
If you get me those batteries, I'll do your helicopter.
Mm-hmm. That would be... Actually, there's some napkin work around here for several years on a helicopter that's quite strange. I actually am a pilot and fly helicopters and have a hangar full of stuff. And I have, for a number of years, basically had a design incorporating an electric motor, but the motor is 26 feet in diameter. And the blades are inside the motor.
Okay.
And the little permanent magnets and the coils are at the outside of the circle. And
that would give you a lot more torque.
It would also take away the anti-torque. You see, on a helicopter, you have to have a tail rotor to compensate for the twisting action of the motor in the center of the thing. If you actually move that to the outside, it goes away. And I've just not ever quite gotten it worked out. But so you can do anything you want to do. If you had 50 180 amp hour cells and a Warp 9 motor and a Soliton, of course, Master Flux, and a recharge car magnetic pickup. At this point, if come September, we count the votes and it's all about you, baby, what are you going to do?
Well, as things stand right now, I would convert the Gremlin.
Okay.
We've looked at it, and the guys and I would like to move forward on the design of 7. We'd like to make a two-seater.
Mm-hmm.
And the issue we keep running into is time and money. I mean, we never thought we were going to spend as much as we did on this one, which I guess compared to your Escalade project is nothing.
The Escalade is trying to break me. It's not winning, but it's actually making a dent.
And you didn't even have to build it from ground up for it to get there.
Right.
But as it stands right now, we would do the A-Team build.
Okay.
We'd call ourselves the I-Team, Illuminati. Uh-huh. And we would convert a fairly inefficient 78 AMC Gremlin, the love of my wife's life, to an electric super vehicle, basically. We don't think we're going to get 200 miles to the gallon out of it. I'm pretty sure, well, and watt hours. Sorry, Nate's slowly converting me to watt hours.
We don't have gallons.
A range, how's that? A range. Uh-huh. I think with about a 30 kilowatt, we would end up with about 100 or 120 mile range in this car.
What's the car weigh?
Offhand, I can't tell you. It's I'd put it at 31 or 3200 pounds.
Really?
Yeah. The engine in it is
bigger than I can remember.
Well, the transmission you have sitting over there is almost the exact same size as the 3-speed transmission it has in it. So it has a large, heavy transmission. It was made to run off of a straight 6 232. Mm-hmm. They had some other numbers for those too, based on bore and stroke. But it also is designed to run off the big block that they put in some of them.
Well, I can't make all this work out for me because of 7. You're at 2,900 pounds. We would normally have that at between 9 times 29, 261 watt hours per mile, and 11 times 2900 would be 319. So between 280 and 320 watt hours per mile, just as a rough. And you're at 155, so that's half of that. So, but that's how we figure regular cars is about 10, a factor of 10 on the weight. If you take your weight and divide it by 10, that's about how many watt hours per mile. So if you're at 3,000, it'd be about 300 watt hours per mile. Let's see, we're doing 50, and I'm 3.35. times 180. That's about the same size kilowatt pack. It's 30 kilowatt pack, and so that would be about 100 miles. But if you can do 155 watt hours per mile, I don't know what it would be. twice that. So it'd be interesting to see. Again, is there anything our viewers ought to know why they ought to vote for Illuminati as the finalist du jour to win the pile? This would be a good time to mention it.
Other than I've got the greatest team in the world, I am very proud of them.
Mm-hmm.
There is one other option on the table that we're trying to work through. We have a couple things against us, but not nearly as many things as we had against us for Building 7.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be the 2-seat Sportster.
Mm-hmm.
The 7 Roadster, as Josh likes to call it.
So what would you call that, an 8? 7.5?
7 of 9, we'd pick a number.
3.5.
Or whatever, yeah. 7 halves, it's half as many seats, gets twice the mileage. We would like to move forward with the designs, and we would like to use more of a customary way of building the cars. We've gathered a lot of knowledge from this build, and we're starting to put some of the materials together in order to make it happen.
So tell me the truth. So, if you had your druthers, would you do a 2-seat 7 or would you do an AMC Gremlin?
If I had my druthers, I'd do the 2-seat 7. But my druthers involve a lot of things falling in place. But I think we can do it.
You had a grand vision, and now you're learning to compromise it to reality. Quit that shit.
I don't
stick with a grand vision.
my grand vision for the two-seater, I brought it down to reality just so people would actually listen to what I say the mileage and speed is. The mileage is 300 miles per gallon, or so that would be about 100 watts
per mile.
Yeah. And its top speed would be about 250 miles per hour. And actually, our estimates for the energy consumption are much lower. Those mm-hmm. are just based on what we got with 7 without making any improvements. Our actual estimates put us slightly higher.
I would urge you to go for the gold and let some lesser team do the gremlin. But that's entirely up to you. We've had Kevin Smith from Illuminati. They're one of our finalists. We'll be showing you some of the other ones as we go along. But I thought we'd do kind of a special feature this week because he brought his car 214 miles on a charge, and I wanted to show the car. The interview for the contest is kind of tacked on here to the end, but I thought our viewers would like to see what you've done, and I'm so glad you came because I found a lot of surprises in there. We're going to have headlights on order probably by the end of the afternoon. Thanks for being with us, Kevin, and thanks for bringing your team down in your car.
Thank you.
I've just had a ball. We're probably going to have a pretty long show next week. Do we have any camera left at all?
We have 16 minutes
to do anything we want.
Holy cow.
You're not really talked out, are you?
No. I mean, I can't believe it.
Cut! Let's quit this!
Wait a minute. You said I 16 minutes.
Masterflux proudly presents the Sierra Series brushless DC variable speed electric compressors. The Masterflux family of compressors are up to 40% smaller and lighter than competing belt-driven DC automotive compressors. Masterflux uses rare earth neodymium magnets for longer life and greater efficiency. The robust rotary design is ideally suited for rugged EV applications. With a scroll type compressor, the process begins with the refrigerant entering the evaporator from the suction side. Refrigerant then travels through a reed valve to the top of the compressor, where it is compressed at up to 8 times the incoming pressure before exiting out the discharge tube to the condenser. Masterflux compressors are available in 400 to 15,000 BTU per hour capacity range for multiple refrigerants, including 134A. Output can be manually adjusted using a simple 0 to 5 volt pot. Masterflux compressors are available to handle input voltages of 12 to 420 volts DC and come with a specific BLDC motor controller for each voltage range. The new Masterflux 2011 product catalog can be downloaded from their website at www.masterflux.com. Masterflux products are available in the US from Revolt Custom Electric Vehicles, in Australia from EV Works, and in South Asia from EV World. Masterflux, the technically elegant choice for powerful electric air conditioning.